Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our panel titled South Asia, Imposed Categories and Imposing Powers. As the title suggests, our aim in this roundtable is to interrogate the category of South Asia as a fairly recent and primarily top-down imposition that perhaps obscures more indigenous and long-standing ways of conceiving and imagining the space. What do we make of the ever-shifting boundaries, the polysemy inherent in the term South Asia, its various members who seem to pull at it from different directions? What does the region look like from other spaces and different vantage points? Most of all, what is gained and what is lost in using South Asia as a category of analysis in the social sciences? We have today with us an exciting set of panelists, most of whom I'm very glad to call my colleagues, who will reflect on some of these questions and focus on them from their own research perspectives. So without much ado, let me introduce the panelists. First of all, we have with us Dr. Anubhuti Maurya, who is Assistant Professor of History in Shivnagar University. And she is a historian of medieval and early modern South Asia. Her research interests include political history of imperial and region formations, cities in modern South Asia, Persianate narrative traditions and spatial practices of the Mughal Empire. And she's also working currently on her monograph on Kashmir in 16th and 17th century when the region was under the Mughal rule. So she will bring to us her perspective from the discipline of history and her own research that looks at space making in this particular region. Next, we have with us Dr. Atul Mishra, who's Associate Professor in the Department of International Relations and Governance Studies at Shivnagar University. And in his research, he examines the ways in which power and hierarchy embodied in Western colonialism has permeated and shaped modern South Asian international relations. He examines ideas and practices of territoriality and sovereignty in modern South Asia, and also works on the emergence of the subcontinent's modern interstate system. So he will bring to us the perspective from within perhaps international relations and as a scholar of South Asian IR. We also are very glad to have with us Dr. Premisha Saha, who's an associate fellow with the Observer Research Foundation Strategic Studies Program. And in her research, she focuses on Southeast Asia, East Asia, and the South Pacific, spanning the Eastern Indian Ocean region. So she's also interested in Indonesian maritime strategy, the emerging dynamics of Indo-Pacific region, India and South Asia. And I'm really looking forward to her perspective, looking at South Asia, perhaps from a maritime perspective, and also from the ways in which this region is apprehended in Southeast Asia. Finally, I'm very glad to introduce Dr. Jubin Jacob, Associate Professor at the Department of International Relations and Governance Studies at Shivnagar University, as well as Adjunct Research Fellow at the National Maritime Foundation, New Delhi. Dr. Jacob's research interests span Chinese domestic politics, China-South Asia relations, Sino-Indian border areas, Indian and Chinese worldviews, and center-province relations in China. And he will bring to us the perspective from perhaps the ways in which China looks at the region. So without much further ado, I invite our panelists to present their views on how they perceive South Asia. We hope to have two rounds. A first opening round where our panelists will reflect on what South Asia means to them from their own research perspectives, as well as from their teaching and perhaps disciplinary interests. And then we will take up themes from there and have another round of conversation before opening it up to the audience. So may I invite you, Anubhuti, first to reflect on the category of South Asia?
Thank you, Medha, and thank you to all the panelists. I'm really looking forward to this conversation today, largely to be able to voice a lot of angst I have on the issue of South Asia. I must begin by saying that I already feel very clever to have been able to log into this meeting. It was quite labyrinthine, the whole procedure. Let me begin by saying that I have deep discomfort with the term South Asia. There is, as a scholar of pre-modern, of course, the question of historicity of this regional complex is something that occupies me. But I understand the utility of the term within the framework, disciplinary frames of international relations. And I am also aware that in this discussion, I may be simply reiterating fact or opinions or perspectives that have already been raised by a number of scholars. But let me begin by spelling out what provokes my discomfort. To begin with, though the term has older provenance, its current usage, in fact, its currency today, draws upon the area studies programs which emerged in the academy, especially of the US, in, you know, of the Cold War, or deeply related to the Cold War, and definitely after the Second World War. And while area studies themselves have evolved from being Sanskrit studies to study the classical languages to being a humanities, the area of humanities to social sciences, there still remains within them certain fundamental problems. Firstly, these are problems of organization. For example, how are these areas that these area studies look at, how are they demarcated? I think the problem is felt especially acutely in the case of Middle East. But also the fact that area studies programs have ridden on funding and funding institutions. So whether we're looking at policies like PL 480, Food for Books programs, which have actually shaped both how libraries are constituted in the Western academies, in the American universities, but also how then people are studying these regions from within the limitations of the material that is then made available through these programs, through funding agencies like Ford Foundations. And that continues to be a part, fundamental part of how area studies are organized. Even today, area studies are about funding, about, if I may use a bad word, patronage. About who dictates publication and who gets to publish where. But more importantly, in the academies, especially in the US, area studies programs have become ghettoized spaces. If you're a historian of South Asia, you're an anthropologist from South Asia, an economist, you're a South Asianist. Do you get to publish in the American Historical Review? Very, very rarely. So Dipesh Chakravarti can impact in good and bad ways on a whole field of South Asian studies, but he's a South Asianist and not a historian or a thinker. And that to me is a problem because what it also entails is training the, what James Scott, I don't know if consciously, but calls the indigenous scholar. And I feel that somehow the area studies programs are fundamentally reinventing the Orientalist wheel, complete with the native informant. At the same time, I am a historian of the pre-modern, writing in post-partition South Asia. Right? And when I use the term South Asia here, it is in deference to the national histories post-1947 of states like India and Pakistan, where these histories are constituted, you know, India constitutes its own history. You know, we have this wonderful, glorious 5,000 years to repeatedly go back to. And Pakistan has been going back to its relationship with the Abbasid Caliphate through the armies of Muhammad bin Qasim. So we have nation states which are developing their own teleologies of the emergence of these nations. So what do you do as a historian? You know, you don't want to say India because that's just not respectful, but you do want to talk about political complexes which are stretching from Kabul to Arakan. How do you address that? And in that, South Asia becomes a term of convenience. But while I say that, and I know that I'm echoing here what Ashish Nandi said in 2005, but what, when I say this here, I'm also aware of the fact that it actually occludes more than it allows, because we still continue to adhere to the boundaries of the nation states. We're just being polite about other areas. What it does not allow is to think of histories in other terms. It does not allow us to think of circulatory histories. It does not allow me to think of Kashmir from, say, Georgia up to Yarkand. Kashmir as implicated in the politics of Gilgit and Hunza. It does not allow me to think of Kashmir, Lhasa, Tibet, and Patna as a network of historical processes. It does not allow for processes to be looked at. And you know, for example, the only area which I think is an exception to this is, of course, the newly emergent Indian Ocean Studies, but now it has become area studies as well. So we are, you know, it's tricky here, I would say. So I can see the utility, but I can also see what it does not allow as clearly. And also I have a deep kind of discomfort with the fact of what South Asia, and I find, and to be slightly more clued into the IR conversation in this panel, I went and looked up a whole lot of stuff, and I keep coming across this whole formulation about political differences, but cultural affinities. And I am a little taken aback at this idea of cultural affinities existing independent of languages or social processes, customs and mores and legal systems being seen as processes or as institutions or without association of power to them, that we can think of ourselves as cultural cognates, to me is a facile assumption. So when we think in terms of South Asia, my question really is, and I pose this largely as a dilemma, more of a dilemma than as something I have a definitive answer to, is does it allow for more capacious thinking? And does it allow us to think of regions in ways which are inclusionary and expansive, as opposed to limiting or replicating existing assumptions? I hope I was within time when I will end my submission here.
Meda, you're on mute.
Yeah, I always tend to do that. So thanks, Jordan. Thank you, Anubhuti, for setting out the context from which our current usage of South Asia emerges, as well as setting down the political economy of the usage of the term, particularly within area studies or from an area studies perspective. I do have some observations, but I think I'd move on to our next panelist right now, Dr. Atul Mishra. Atul, please come in.
Thank you so much, Meda. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining this conversation. There are two things that I want to take off from what Anubhuti said. One is about this struggle that anyone who's doing any kind of academic scholarship in our part of the world has vis-a-vis striking this balance between being labeled an area studies person simply because you are located over here and you're dealing with the region. At the same time, you bring in your disciplinary perspective to the region that you study. So that balance, striking that balance, is not just a problem with historians who study South Asia, but also international relations people who study South Asia. And especially when you're in a conversation with Western scholars, you have to struggle very hard to forefront yourself as a disciplinary scholar or an interdisciplinary scholar, but a scholar nevertheless, or in an academic sense, and not an area studies person. So that's point number one. The second point is, of course, I think I want to sort of nuance this notion of the provenance of the term itself. We do find evidence at least terms like, in one instance, South Asia, but also Southern Asia, going back to writings about South Asia from within South Asia to about 1920s. But I think Anubhuti is very substantively on point when she says that the way in which this term acquires its heft somewhat unfortunately, has got a lot to do with the Cold War project and the way in which Americans were actually mapping parts of the world for their own strategic interests, great power interests, and if you like, imperial interests. To me, South Asia is, as an academic, as somebody who sort of studies South Asia, it's a category that is immensely frustrating. And the reason why it is frustrating is because no singular conception of South Asia. So basically, it's a catch-all in which you sort of, you know, you try and through which you try and make sense of a number of, if you like, geographies or constellations that cut across modern boundaries or post-colonial boundaries. But also, I feel, as far as a regional reality is concerned, South Asia is a political geography created by partition, fundamentally, or it bears the scars of partition in ways more than one. And what we, in order to sort of really grasp this, what we need to focus on is the 1940s. The two things are important there. One is, of course, no one is anticipating the kind of South Asia that eventually emerges. There are some who sort of say that, you know, if partition, some people are speculating about the consequences of partition in one or two areas. But you know, on a subcontinental level, nobody believes that you will have a partition that will end up creating a very flawed, quote unquote, interstate order. Which is not to say that they actually were clear about what kind of post-colonial entity they will emerge, but at least there was great clarity that it would not, or nobody imagined that it would be an interstate order of the sort that emerged. And what was the sort of interstate order that we had? I think fundamentally, for a very long time, it was defined by the rivalry between India and Pakistan, even before Pakistan sort of became truncated, especially before it became truncated. And one way in which we can see that rivalry playing out, at least in the discursive domain, is while in India, there was a lot of emphasis on describing the region as an Indian subcontinent, in Pakistan, especially pre-1971 literature, you're calling it an Indo-Pak subcontinent. And that to me is a very, the idea of that discursive contestation, or the history of that discursive contestation, is worth actually pondering a little. So what has happened as a result, I feel, is that states have very reluctantly and very late in the day arrived at some kind of a region-making exercise. And because of the multiple pulls and pressures, you know, there's no one governing logic that brings all the nation states of the region together. And because of the multiple pulls and pressures, regionalism has struggled. And to the extent that regionalism has struggled, and if you're invested in any kind of region-wide integrity, which is not primarily driven by Delhi, Islamabad, Dhaka, and Kathmandu, and so on and so forth, you do feel a little frustrated with it. So let me stop here at this stage, and maybe we'll have a second round where I sort of want to contribute in other ways as well. Thank you very much.
Right. Thank you, Atul, for also underscoring perhaps the endogeneity of the term South Asia. I believe it was Aga Khan III who first used it in the 1920s, while referring to perhaps possible futures of this area. But as Anubhuti pointed out, and you too did, that it does owe a lot of how we use it is owed to the area studies construction and US interests post World War II. But I think you also brought out an important part about aspect, which is that how it is also perhaps a neutral way of referring to the post-partition geography of this region. And that is something perhaps that we can reflect on more in the second round, the utility of this term, even as it obscures so much. I turn now to Dr. Premisha Saha. And Premisha, if you could reflect a bit more on how does this region look like from a maritime perspective? I think we're all rather tied to a continental perspective when we think of South Asia.
Thank you, Medha. I would like to first thank Shivnathu University for inviting me to join this panel. Yes, there are a few thoughts that I also reflect on that are first two panelists have pointed out, I think Atul very rightly pointed out, this is a term of neutrality, because there have been huge debates of how India predominates the whole South Asia debate. I think there is a reason for that. The reason primarily being that India is the connecting link when it comes to South Asia. So that has to be kept in mind. You spoke about the maritime links. Now let me directly go into that. Even in the traditional times, if we see how the trade routes and how the various, say, the trading routes, which are termed as Silk Road, Clove Route, even with China's BRI, technically is trying to revive the old maritime Silk Route. All this, in a way, had the predominance when we were talking about trading with the South Asian region. It was predominantly trading with India in those regards. So, for instance, I did my PhD on Indonesia. I did spend a lot of time there doing archival research and stuff like that. So let me point out how, from the Southeast Asian perspective, the largest archipelago country in that geography, traditionally in terms of maritime, looked at South Asia and also India. So, because historically, Southeast Asia draws a lot from its legacy of the past when it comes to even present policy making. So that is also a reason why, looking at history and looking at how they traditionally looked at trading routes, and because they are also in their own maritime policies, indigenous maritime policies, trying to revive that of the past things. So for instance, in the past, there were considered to be 5 major commercial zones, according to Indonesian archival literature and also Indonesian scholars who have written in their own Bahasa language, that there were 5 commercial trading zones which operated in this area. And one of them was India, but it came under the cluster of Bay of Bengal. So under Bay of Bengal, it covered South India, Sri Lanka, and Burma. Again, if we look at Sri Vijaya and Majapahit kingdoms, for example, they looked at India as Dvipantra, which means it covered India, China, and the Asian region, South India, East India. So again, and why am I saying all these things? Because Anubhuti very clearly pointed out about cultural, why we speak about cultural affinity in the things is, many much culture originated where these debates are always going to continue. For instance, in Southeast Asia, there is still a debate about where Bahasa originated, whether in Malaysia or in Indonesia. Such debates are always going to continue. But for instance, we also have to identify that these kingdoms, which I just mentioned, were Hindu-Buddhist kingdoms, were Hindu kingdoms, which also in a large way had to do with the trading, traditional trading that happened between India and, say, North Sumatra and the Sumatra region through the Java Sea. So these kind of traditional maritime linkages have to be looked into. The thing about demarcating regions, we initially started off with Asia-Pacific. Now we have the Indo-Pacific. So I think it also does a lot with how states' interests revolve around it. Now Indo-Pacific is catering to the interest of everybody. So now we are harping on the term Indo-Pacific, but really how different is it from Asia-Pacific? So in terms of geography, that also needs to be seen. To me, South Asia is essentially a geographical demarcation. It represents a neutrality because in many ways it shows the predominance of India. Now coming to the contemporary times, yes, it is. There is a lot of advantage for India because it leaves a lot of room for South Asian diplomacy. But at the same time, it poses a lot of responsibility. For instance, in the Indian Ocean region, we can't say Indian Ocean region as, because Eastern Indian Ocean region brings in Southeast Asia, to some extent also Australia. Western Indian Ocean region can cater to South Asia, but then it includes the eastern coast of Africa as well. So I think that way South Asia again is comfortable in those regards, if you are pointing about that geography. Also, that one thing that needs to be looked at is when we are looking at, say, the Indian Ocean region, India is said to be the net security provider. In terms of naval capabilities, do we have that entire capability to be the net security provider? I think India itself now recognizes that. And in recent maritime and recent speeches of PM Modi, that's why he's talking about how we should be working with other countries like Australia, US, France, UK in this region, who also have presence in Indian Ocean in terms of territories and bases. So those kind of things are also developing. There is middle part diplomacy, which is developing, which in itself shows that the predominance of India, is it really continuing, or India is now working with like-minded countries? So India in itself is now working with like-minded countries. So the predominance of India, how much is it going to, you know, in what way is it continuing? That narrative has also changed. The way the predominance of India was perceived when we were demarcating South Asia has now changed to working with like-minded countries, for instance. So working alongside. Another thing is, when we look at South Asia from Southeast Asia, to Southeast Asia, South Asian diplomacy is working with India because predominantly of the NAM, the non-aligned movement, where again, India was the facilitator, the main facilitator. So that kind of things, even when you talk of Indian Ocean diplomacy, to them, it is India. It is not so much that concept is changing a little because now we are seeing Pakistan, Myanmar developing ties, Bangladesh, Indonesia developing ties, but it is still predominantly India, which centers around the diplomacy when it comes to from the Southeast Asian perspective. So again, that to a level has not yet been, but can be utilized by China for its own advantage. For instance, showing the other South Asian neighbors how to Southeast Asia also in this geography, it is India which is predominant, and then helping connect the other parts of South Asia to the Southeast Asian geography. So that can be utilized. So there are pros and cons in both ways. So we have to very carefully tailor our policy making. And with this, I would like to conclude. And in the second session, I would address any questions and queries. And
right. Thanks a lot, Premisha. And I think you brought about a key controversial factor related to South Asia or the conception of South Asia as a region, which is the predominance and perhaps even hegemony of India. And as you pointed out, with regard to historical links, it perhaps also has to do with the fact that historically this region was India or the Indian subcontinent. And that is something that perhaps all members of this region have to deal with, or even social scientists, when we look at and analyze the region, and the problem becomes particularly pertinent when we look at it historically. How do we deal with the India factor? And another thing that I found really interesting when you mentioned the maritime links is this Bay of Bengal perspective. And the fact that even though we demarcate the region based on its subcontinental attributes, there are other connections which might actually relate the region to other geographies. So that's something to consider as well. You did bring in the China factor, so I'd really like to hear the views of Jubin as well. So Dr. Jubin Jacob, please come in. And I mean, we cannot, I think, avoid China in South Asia anymore. So I'd invite you to present your views.
Thank you, Medha. And let me also take this moment to thank NIICE for this invitation. I think this is a rather interesting and important subject, and the fact that we have scholars from different disciplines and different area studies focus at this panel sort of helps this discussion along in many ways. We are also learning from each other as the conversation goes along. So let me start by saying that, you know, Anubhuti has already pointed out the origins of the concept, and she's spot on in terms of the impact that it continues to have on research, on teaching methodology in India and elsewhere in South Asia. You know, that said, today, by force of socialization, by many years of use, South Asia, the concept or the category of South Asia has become a rather convenient shorthand for teachers, for researchers, for outsiders, as well as for insiders. For outsiders, it's just useful to describe one of the most ethnically diverse, linguistically diverse, and politically fractious regions on the planet, anywhere on the planet, right? But also dominated by India. For those of us inside, as Anubhuti pointed out, you know, for us, our thinking is from Afghanistan to the Arakan, present in Myanmar. And Premisha has just pointed out that, you know, there is also this maritime dimension, you know, the Bay of Bengal complex, the Arabian Sea regional complex, all of which have also impacted on our history, on our thinking. Even in India today, just take the sort of discussions ongoing between, you know, within the military, between the army and the navy, you know, when you talk about China, the focus is always essentially on the land boundary dispute. But from the Navy perspective, China is also entering the Indian Ocean, and therefore we also need to think of the Indian Ocean as part of our thinking on South Asia. Now, from a teaching point of view, as somebody who teaches China to South Asian students or Indian students, or largely talks about China to a South Asian audience, how does China look at South Asia? Now, for the Chinese also, one thing we have to remember is that the Chinese are only recent neighbors to South Asia. It's only post their invasion or the occupation of Tibet and Xinjiang that China actually comes into contact with South Asia. So despite whatever we might read in history textbooks about Fashian and Xuanzang, and despite contemporary rhetoric, these links have been largely tenuous for much of history. And it's only now that China is sort of imposing itself on South Asia and trying to come up with its own categories. I mean, Atul pointed this out, that Pakistan constantly tries to sort of undermine or create new categories. Anubhuti also pointed this out. Its own version of history of South Asia, starting with the entry of Mohammed bin Qasim and so on. So South Asia is unique among other parts, compared to other parts of the world, in that each of its constituents is constantly trying to pull away from this South Asian identity of theirs. Myanmar on the one side will, prefers to consider itself as part of ASEAN. Afghanistan and Pakistan, can also consider themselves as part of a Central Asian regional complex. So, I think the dominant reason there is because of India's centrality. Everybody is trying to pull themselves out or escape India's pull. Now, the Chinese have literally aped the Americans in many ways because of their sort of recent entry or recent contact with South Asia. And this includes adopting the category of South Asia in their academia, in their diplomacy. My sense is the Chinese do not really understand South Asia very well. And actually, this is not surprising, because if you think about it, the Americans who impose the category of South Asia have also not understood South Asia very well. Look at their sort of withdrawal from Afghanistan. So, from a teaching point of view, this complicates matters, because we are using, as the title of the panel says, an imposed category. But within that imposed category, the people who impose those categories, we simply are not able to make sense of sometimes of their policies. For me, I think a much better categorization perhaps would be Southern Asia, because this is a conception of the region that also includes Tibet and Xinjiang, as well as the maritime dimension. And it's also far more accurate culturally and historically speaking. I mean, these regions, the maritime area that Premesha talked about, or Tibet and Xinjiang, have as much connection to South Asia, to India, if not more, than they do with the Chinese heartland. So, and also from a contemporary perspective, I think Tibet and Xinjiang also fit well within this instability complex that South Asia represents. Afghanistan, Pakistan, parts of India that are constantly in states of churn and tension. So perhaps, it's not just about South Asia, but also identifying other categories or thinking about other categories to help explain South Asia to our students, as well as to people studying South Asia. So I will stop with that, Medha. Over to you.
Thanks a lot, Jabin. And I think you brought in the teaching aspect and the usefulness of the category from that perspective. And I think one thing that does come up over and over again in everyone's conversation is this fact that the term South Asia, even though it might have been imposed and even though it is problematic in many ways, it does serve as a convenient marker or a neutral term to deal with post-partition geographies. My question to you, to all the panelists right now, is how do we best make use of this term while being aware of the various problems that it brings to the fore, particularly, I would say, this hegemony of India within this region, and the tendency perhaps to see South Asia as India in many ways. And that happens not just, I mean, we're all scholars based in India reflecting on this in some ways. And as Premisha also pointed out, that from an Indonesian perspective, South Asia is India. And I think to a large extent, perhaps the area studies perspective also is dominated by the category of India. And of course, a lot of this also has to do with the fact that the term South Asia also emerged from concerns of Indology and Oriental, as Anubhuti pointed out, Oriental scholars to deal with what happens post-partition to this particular area of study. So that is what I would like to ask of you, but of course, please feel free to riff off each other as well if you found anything interesting. Anubhuti, may I ask you to come back in to start off our second round?
I'm still thinking about much of what was said, and I don't really have a quarrel with the point about convenience, especially in the context of post-partition geographies. I'm a historian primarily of Kashmir, and I know that a Kashmiri would be far more comfortable with South Asia than it would be with India. What I'm wondering is what are the possibilities that get opened up to us when we imagine the region to be a crisscross as opposed to definitively marked only by political boundaries. So that was just some of the stuff that I was thinking about. In response to the discussion that we've had, people pointed to the question of older provenance. From what I understand is that actually before South Asia, India was very much considered a part of Southeast Asia within the area studies complex. And I would be interested in hearing more about that. So that's one. The second is, of course, what are the other kind of, the question to be posed is that say we say that, you know, we agree on the fact that South Asia, currently is dominated by the sense imbued to it by the area studies departments. Do we have alternative imaginations of this region possible? Of course, historically, there are multiple kinds of ways in which this area has been written about. And I'm not talking only about Jambudvipa of Hindustan, but also of orientations within the regions in multiple different ways. And I think that it may be, it may help to excavate those histories far more effectively before we become entirely comfortable with using the term South Asia. That is what I would like to say. I'm surprised Atul didn't bring up the Akhandata of the Bharat as yet. And I was wondering when is that going to come up? That said, I think I like Jabin's proposition about Southern Asia. And I was also interested in hearing your what you think on this matter, Meera.
Right, thanks, Anubhuti. So, I mean, I just like you, I think, find the category deeply problematic because I study it from an IR perspective, but historically. And I think it does obscure a lot in terms of, especially in terms of making the region as in composed of nation states. I think that is the biggest problem that I see with the category of South Asia. But I've also found in my experience that this is a neutral term in the sense that a lot of people, other members other than Indian, and that too mainstream Indian, as you point out, members of this so-called region, much prefer the term to, say, Indian subcontinent, for instance. So in that sense, it might be more inclusive? I'm still struggling with that aspect. But you brought out the Akhandata aspect, right? So that inclusivity is also questionable, perhaps. You want to come in?
Yeah, I can't find the raise hand button. I'm sorry to interrupt you. Move on to Atul. The reason why I continue to be making faces actually at the use of the term is because, it's like the European departments are still comfortable calling themselves Indology departments.
Yeah.
And, you keep wondering, don't you see the problems with the term? These terminologies are not independent of, their values. I feel that before we become comfortable with it, unless we redefine it in very different ways, it just re-perpetuates or reiterates existing baggage.
Right, I completely agree with you. And I think, I'm also reflecting on what you said about the fact that this idea of cultural contiguity, it obscures so much, so many power relations, right? And the construction of majorities and minorities in the region. Or rather culturally hegemonic majorities, because I think if we look at it from a regional perspective, then the majority.
Yeah, it makes like Indo-Pakistan relations into ugly affairs of people. It's not, right?
That's true, yeah. But I don't want this to become a to and fro between us. So let me quickly invite Atul. I'm sure he has a lot to say about this as well.
Thank you, Anubhuti and Medha. Just as I was reflecting on the number of points that you made in your summative statement, Medha, about how do we then, for the lack of a better term, reimagine South Asia, or at least have conceptions of South Asia that take us beyond the category as a catch-all and as some kind of a hegemonic category, and I think reference was made to this. So initially, I thought, just as we were talking about, I thought I'd reflect a little more on the on a hegemonic, contemporary hegemonic conception of South Asia, which is, of course, the conception that is foregrounded by the ideology that is currently dominant in the in India, not in the subcontinent. It has the aspiration to dominate the subcontinent, which is the notion of Akhand Bharat. Now, there is Akhand Bharat maximum or maximalist, which sort of goes all the way to, which encompasses what Javan would describe as Southern Asia. So, there's Tibet, not Xinjiang, but Tibet, there's Afghanistan, definitely, and it will go all the way into Ramesha's terrain, to sort of Southeast Asia. But there is also a certain notion of Akhand Bharat, which emerges in the context of the early 20th century conflict between two of South Asia's largest communities. And in that sense, you have a slightly more, a concept which sort of says that we need to, quote unquote, revert back to a geography, a political and cultural geography that comprises most of, all of Pakistan, parts of modern day Afghanistan, some indeterminate part of Myanmar, but everything to its west and in the quote unquote peripheries. But just as we were sort of talking about it, I thought that there is a three-level conceptualization of South Asia that we can try and look at, not necessarily approving at least one of them. So let's think of a hegemonic conception of South Asia, right? So let's call it, for example, today, the Akhand Bharat idea, which is hyper-hegemonic, if you like, because if, the Indian conception of South Asia was at one point called, dubbed hegemonic. I never thought that it was hegemonic. It was aspirational. It was hegemonic in aspiration, but never, I think, in outcome. Often in practice, yes. But so let's think of a hegemonic conception of South Asia. Pick whatever you wish to. And then you have this sort of neutral, interstate-oriented conception of South Asia. Neutralish, if not neutral, but fairly inclusive of South Asia itself. And then, which is interesting, and which is what fascinates me incredibly, is this, a constellation is a bad word, so maybe a network of interlinking sub-regions in a manner that if you are, for example, in Shehre-Nor in Kabul, you will have some kind of an understanding of what might possibly be going on in Dhaka, even though that intelligibility will not be immediate, and it will be it would filter through a number of other sub-regions. Now, let's just look at some of the examples, right? What is a natural sub? What is a major natural sub-region, for example, in the northwestern part? It is the Punjab. You go, for example, in the eastern part, you have Bengal. But to me, one way in which the sub-regions actually make a comeback very significantly is when you sort of try and, when hegemonic dispensations, for whatever reasons, try and, you know, rob them of their identities. So, for example, NWFP and NEFA, these are attempts on the part of hegemonic ambitious entities to rob certain regions of their sub-regions of their identity. But these sub-regions do make a comeback. So, you know, NWFP would become Khyber Pakhtunkhwa and NEFA would sort of revert back to whatever, at least regain some kind of a cultural identity. You know, back in the 19th century, the region, the sub-region around Delhi, etc., was called the Northwest province. You know, so, and it was Northwest in relation to Calcutta. But at some point, you know, you end up, you know, the region ends up claiming itself and sort of becomes Agra Division. Anubhuti would correct me on the geographical accuracy of it. But the illustrative point again, you know, there is an aspirate, there is a province or there is an area that Pakistan would very much like to become one of its newest provinces. And for a very long time, you called it Northern Areas, right? So Northern Areas has actually, you know, even their culture has sort of made a comeback. So you have all of these resilient sub-regions. And to me, those resilient sub-regions are a good starting point to think about the region in a slightly more accommodative manner. So thinking of a macro-cultural region, which is a federation of these sub-regions, would be maybe one way of breaking out of the current impasse that we have in some conceptions of South Asia. So maybe this by way of a response initially, over to you.
Thank you, Atul. I think that's fascinating. And also I think reminds me of what, as in connects to perhaps what Jagan said about bringing in Xinjiang and Tibet into South Asia. And that's a more regional or sub-regional way of conceiving of the region. It also reminds me of this concept of zomia, which was proposed by Jean Michaud, I believe, an anthropologist who talks about creating or rather considering the social space as composed of Southwest China, Northeast India, parts of Bangladesh, Eastern Bangladesh particularly, some parts of Burma, Thailand, Vietnam, Laos, Cambodia, Malaysia, Taiwan, and Indonesia as one social space and studying it as such. So that's perhaps another sub-regional way of conceiving of a nation and breaking apart, the space as such and breaking apart the nation state boundaries and perhaps also being more historically accurate. I do wonder what Premisha has to say about this.
A lot of interesting thoughts, actually. I was actually enjoying listening to it, but now that I have to speak about it. I think the fact that how can we maneuver around this advantages and disadvantages, I think disadvantages have been, I agree with Anubhuti in many ways about the area studies perspective, how this is essentially a Western drawn concept of having area studies and stuff like that. But let me draw on the sub-regions part. Right? There is a way of how India can maneuver this to its advantage, which I can think of. For instance, everybody was talking about sub-regions. Let me talk about some sub-region organizations also which are coming into picture. There's BIMSTEC, there is Mekong Ganga Cooperation. All this have been there. I'm a scholar at first, so obviously these have not taken off the way it should have, but they are still existent. And in many ways, it's India who is the main facilitator of all these sub-regional organizations. BBIN, the BCIM, name and you have as many as you want. I think in terms of kicking this off in a bigger way with the partner countries, would in a way give the idea that India is not trying to be the hegemon, or even if it is trying to be the dominant power, it is actually also pulling countries to work along with it. So I think that way you have a lot to do. In terms of bigger regional organizations, say for instance, if we talk about the maritime way, the IORA, for instance, in IORA, there is a very big advantage of what each member state demands of it. That difference will always be there. Whereas there are some similar interests from countries, say India, Australia, Indonesia. But again, what African nations demand of the IORA is very different to what, say, India, Australia, and Indonesia demand of it. So again, getting a hegemony there, or sorry, getting a similar understanding there is very difficult to get among 21 member countries. So I think sub-regional organization in a way paves the way for that. And I think when we are talking about the current diplomacy, how it is working, I think the buzzwords have become minilaterals and plurilaterals and whatever laterals you can think of. So it is like how these trilaterals are also coming into being. The main reason being it is easier to get a consensus among 3 or 4 countries rather than getting among 10 countries, and ASEAN is the biggest example of that currently. And there are now questions about, should we really be pondering on ASEAN centrality when we talk about the Indo-Pacific? So for that, I think I would say, let's talk about the dominance of the Southeast Asian geography. If you're not talking about ASEAN centrality, talk about the Southeast Asian geography. It is not so much to do with ASEAN centrality, it is to do with how geographically Southeast Asia is situated in Indo-Pacific. You can't do Indo-Pacific without Southeast Asia. It's right in the middle of the two oceans. So I think that ways you should think about the Southeast Asian geography dominance rather than talking about an ASEAN centrality, given how ASEAN is moving towards, especially given the Myanmar crisis, the South China Sea crisis and stuff. But I think for India to move on, besides the sub-region, in the maritime domain, India is doing initiatives like Sagar, for instance. So there are ways, and also we are doing initiatives like the Indo-Pacific Oceans Initiative, where we are talking about working with other countries. So I think that attempt has already been started to be made from the Indian side about how India can bring in other players of South Asia, not just South Asia, also Southeast Asia, Oceania, the bigger Indo-Pacific geography. But since today we are talking about South Asia, we are talking about cooperating in the maritime way with countries like Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Seychelles. So all this is happening in the maritime domain also through the Sagar initiative, not so much the IPOI yet, but at least the Sagar initiative for the moment. So I think there are already attempts being made in that regard. So how much it continues and what more ways can be developed is whole another conversation, and I'm ready to take on it in the third go or whatever if questions arise. But for now, I think the attempt has already been made.
Great. Thanks a lot, Premisha. So not just sub-regional, but perhaps supra-regional conceptions as well that sort of subsume South Asia into larger constructs. Chabin, I wonder what China would make of these sub-regional and supra-regional aspirations.
Well, actually, sort of China, given China's identity now, or self-identity as a rising power or putative global superpower, I think that's a useful segue into actually addressing the question of Indian hegemony itself. I think perhaps this idea of Indian hegemony is overdrawn. For those of us inside India, India is certainly hegemonic. And the Indian state is hegemonic. Different parts of India, different corners, or now peripheries, but formerly centers of trade and regional identity once upon a time. For them, yes, the Indian state can be hegemonic. But if you look at it, India is not as hegemonic as the state or the government of India itself wishes to be inside South Asia. Despite India's centrality, like I said before, most states in the region are trying to pull away. I mean, Myanmar is very clearly identifying itself as a Southeast Asian country. It doesn't have any reason to identify itself as South Asian because there's really no connectivity with South Asia, with India, with India's borders at, with the Northeast. Pakistan, as has already been said, is also trying to concede. Even India is trying to escape South Asia. I mean, you look at India's attempts to talk about the non-aligned movement or the Bandung system, or that is in the immediately post-independence. But even today with the Quad, I mean, I would say India wants to escape South Asia because it's not able to impose its will on South Asia. And here China is important because what China is doing is imposing its will on South Asia in many ways, changing and shaping the category of South Asia with the help of its economic might. I think the Chinese have understood India's difficulties in maintaining its hegemony or centrality in South Asia, right? In fact, what we understand as South Asia outside of this region is essentially an India-Pakistan dyad. Most scholars of South Asia will not think of other countries as much as the conflict over Kashmir or the fact that these are two nuclear armed neighbors and this is a dangerous part of the world, et cetera, all right? Narrow or as limiting as those categories are, these are convenient ways in which the rest of the world looks at South Asia. But for the Chinese, I think they have understood and taken advantage of these problems that India faces in its neighborhood. I mean, we have to understand there's a question of state capacity. India wants to be hegemonic. India has this concept of Akhand Bharat and all the rest of it. But what capacity does it have to impose any of these categories or ideas on the rest of the region? Even the sort of motivating ideology behind Akhand Bharat is seen as problematic, even in another Hindu country like Nepal, right? So what the Chinese have done is use their economic capacity to build a new region, a region of economic of physical and infrastructural connectivity, of economic connectivity. So you see, we are talking to, hosted by an institution from Nepal. You look at how the Chinese have targeted the northern borders of Nepal as a way of integrating those areas closer to more deeply with Tibet. And this is one way of trying to establish or solidify Chinese rule over Tibet, because they do not want tensions spilling over from Nepal into Tibet, right? Look at how China is trying to pull Pakistan away from the South Asian or Indian orbit with the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor under the Belt and Road Initiative. The Chinese are involved in Sri Lanka. The Chinese have the economic corridor running through Myanmar. So if you look at it, it's China that is now reshaping the region that is South Asia and pulling all of these little countries or smaller countries out of India's orbit, whatever orbit might have existed. So now we only have maybe a cultural tie, but we do not have any infrastructure linkages, any economic ties. Even trade between India and Pakistan goes through Dubai. So I think despite the sort of different regional, sub-regional organizations that Premisha talked about, essentially India is in a deadlock. And that deadlock is best represented by another organization that nobody has talked about, which is SAARC. It's a sorry example of a regional organization anywhere in the world. India, South Asia itself, intra-South Asian trade is just 5 or 10%, which is among the least of any region in the world. So I think, we should not overplay the idea that India is a hegemon. India wants to be a hegemon, but it isn't. I'll stop it at that.
Right. I think, when I said hegemonic, I meant more discursively in the sense that when one thinks of South Asia, at least from outside of India or outside of this region, people generally tend to think of India. And in the sense that when one really looks at South Asia, when one wants to, then perhaps Islam is the dominant region in this religion in this area. But when one studies it more from the perspective of the ancient Hindu civilization, the Indology departments, the area studies departments. And that is what I find really fascinating. And that is what I meant. But yes, of course, politically speaking, it is aspirational hegemony, as Atul put it. I'd like to very quickly bring in Atul here with regard to the point that you made about Akhand Bharat and the fact that there is no way for those proponents of that to actually impose it on the region. What do you think, Atul?
So thank you, Medha. Before I actually talk about it, a couple of interesting observations again. One from Premisha. If I understood her correctly, I thought it was fascinating that even though in the context of the Indo-Pacific, ASEAN kind of as a regional grouping experiences a diminishing in its importance. But Southeast Asia as a geography kind of increases, the salience of South Asia and Southeast Asia as a geography sort of goes up. And to me, that's another way in which there is a certain dynamic character to how geographies, the fate of geography sort of goes up and down. So that was point number one. Point number two, Jabin touched upon it, which is, you know, the whole bit about you have a conception of Akhand Bharat emerging from India, and it is opposed by, you know, neighbors whom people over here or some people over here would like it to actually be accepted by. And, you know, there's one particular ideologue of Akhand Bharat. He doesn't talk about it explicitly, but one ideologue of Akhand Bharat, Savarkar, I remember very clearly in a book called Six Glorious Epochs of Indian History, actually says that Sri Lanka is baby India. And we must treat Nepal very similar to the way in which we treat, for example, Maharashtra or any other state of India. Now, to me, what that is suggestive of is very clearly, you know, choose your word, disregard, positive contempt, and an aspiration to undo the sovereignties of some of the smaller geographies of the region. And to that extent, I think that is what I think it makes it undesirable from a normative point of view, international relations normative point of view. It's a geography that ends up undermining the sovereignty of states in the neighborhood. The second point I want to make is that even though in its aspiration, it continues to have a political character. So for example, there are two or three things about it which are fascinating to me. One is, you know, the ultimate idea is for to undo partition and bring about a territorial consolidation of the region with both a political as well as cultural dominance of the people who constitute the majority in South Asia. I think because very over a period of time, it has been realized that the political component of it and the territorial component of it is very hard to sort of achieve. It has the cultural side of it has kind of become very significant. So in recent months, for example, and over the past 2-3 years, as kind of there's an injection of a greater level of confidence among the dispensation in India, the fronting of the cultural element of Akhand Bharat has happened very centrally, and people have endorsed the idea itself. So, for example, in one instance, about two or three months ago, we had someone fairly higher up in the hierarchy of the ideological structure in India saying that, you know, the misfortunes of quote unquote misfortunes of Pakistan and Afghanistan are largely on account of the fact that they moved out of the configuration called Akhand Bharat. So there is that element to think about. So the fronting of the cultural element, because the political and the territorial elements at the moment seem quite impossible from their point of view at the moment. Now, the other thing to me that is fascinating is a certain millenarian character to the project. So, you know, you ask some of the firmer believers of the project, they would say that, you know, we are willing to wait for this to sort of happen over centuries if required, because this is ultimately something that needs to happen. Now, to me, that millenarianism, especially expressed politically, is a new entity. You know, this is something that you would sort of associate with, if I'm not incorrect, Abrahamic religions. You know, there's a certain element of things happening, you know, major political events unfolding over a fairly long period of time. I know Hanupati's made faces there, maybe you could contest, but so there is a certain millenarian character, which I think is very interesting. But what is also very interesting are two other points. One is that, you know, the proponents of Akhand Bharat and sympathizers of Akhand Bharat are deeply uncomfortable with both any characterization of the region as a continent or a subcontinent, because they think that it is basically reduces the region to a geography, takes out all of its cultural element, whereas they would sort of want a certain homogeneous conception of homogeneous culture. The second element is that they also are uncomfortable with South Asia. It's a meaningless category, because very clearly there is a deep cultural imprint of one particular religion across uh, a, across South Asia. Now, my answer to that question is just yes. Sorry, you're muted, Medha. We're running out of time?
We are running out of time. Five minutes left. So.
Absolutely. Yeah. No. We can just go on and on about this, but let's wrap this. Let me stop here. Yeah.
Sorry to interrupt you there.
Not at all.
But I do want to bring in Anubhuti now, because I think you mentioned Akhand Bharat, which is, I suppose, a very exclusive and hegemonic way of conceiving of the region. And there have been other conceptions, perhaps, that may have been more inclusive. Anubhuti, do you see any possibility of a revival of Hindustan? And I think this might also answer perhaps a question that has been posed in the chat by Sagar Jankarki, which is about the fact that is there a possibility to broaden or expand our viewpoint with regard to South Asia beyond national boundaries and in more inclusive ways? And if there is a possibility of partnership between India and Pakistan in the future. So if you could come in and
only a historian. I'm a historian, not a prophet. So, I do want to say, what is this millenarianism? Is Abrahamic? It's literally like Kalki, you know, one word for you, Kalki. And it is making, the cult of Kalki is making a revival currently across North India. Okay. But very briefly to respond to you, the idea of Hindustan, a revival of it, yes, great, would be wonderful. I'm actually far more in favor of, and also I want to say this is the first time, I mean, hyper hegemonic, macro something something, supra regional, I have not seen such beautiful use of extravagant adjectives to describe simple concepts as this. But what I think we need to look at is move away from older frames of thinking about histories of these regions that we are talking about. And if you want to move away from thinking of these regions only through the paradigm of boundaries and state formations, then we also have to move away from histories of violence, to not see history so much as making of state formations or making of regions through the movement of armies, but to move to other kinds of imaginations about these regions, to look at the movement of people, the movement of ideas, to look at movement of objects. And if we can come to that kind of, Barry Flood has this wonderful phrase, transculturation, problematic, but I think that is one way of rethinking, in which then again, we can think of, relations between Tibet, Xinjiang, Patna and Kathmandu. We can think about the conversation, say, between the rulers of Nepal and the Himalayan kingdoms of the Dogras. We can think of conversations between the Malabar, the Coromandel, the Bay of Bengal, and Southeast Asia, and Malacca, and Hormuz, and Aden, and Zanzibar. So I think that the way forward is not actually to become far more, clingy to our national boundaries, but to actually think of other kinds of processes that are taking place. As far as the India-Pakistan thing is concerned, let's just say that there is a limit to optimism.
Right. Thank you, Anubhuti. So we do have some questions in the chat, and I think we have about a minute left. So I'll just quickly read those out, and if perhaps Premisha and Jabin could weave these into their closing remarks. So there's a question by Anna Nath Ganguly, which is to all panelists. Do you think South Asia geographical demarcation and politico-economic approach are in contradiction? We keep mentioning that geographical demarcation influenced foreign policy, but is SAR countries really conducting its relations on such conventional aspects? And then there's a question by Arundhati Sharma, who's asking about how we see India leading sub-regionalism into the regional construct of SAR. Is it reinforcing hegemonic aspirations or diluting it, particularly perceived from the leader-follower framework? So, Premisha and
Jabin
for closing remarks.
I think we have to, it's contradiction when it comes to geography and political economics. I think there might be an element of contradiction, but at the same time, there also has to be sometimes, for instance, maritime trade initially did a lot with the fact that how much close you are to each other, how close you are located to each other. Now, given rising technologies and facts, faraway trades and maritime trades, 70% of trading happens to that realm. So I think it is not contradiction, it is an advancement on the basis of that. But when it comes to how South Asian region, whether they are just looking at geography, and I think it's both, because economy, as Jabin very rightly mentioned, if it would not be economic clout or how much economic advantage this brings in, then the China factor would not have come into the picture in the first place. I think so. That way, the economy factor is still there, and how India can, rejuvenate sub-regionalism. So I think there are many ways, but India alone cannot do it. I mean, it can lead the way, but at the same time, there has to be other countries which goes along the way with India. And by going along the way, I don't mean a leader and a follower sort of a way. What I mean is, if India can cater to the interests of those parties, what India needs to see is what are the interests of the other member countries. Because catering to those interests would in a way facilitate India's foreign policy as well. It's not only going to just, I'm catering to the interest of say an ABC country, that is not sufficing my interest. It's not going to be that. At the end, it is going to be a dot on your South Asian diplomacy as well, which currently is not doing so well. Mm-hmm. So in that way, reviving South Asian regionalism, India has to take the leap ahead. But other countries also need to voice about their interests, which they actually mm-hmm. do. But India doesn't always take that into consideration, because as Jabin very clearly mentioned, that India is also now trying to move away from the South Asian complex mm-hmm. and entering into Indo-Pacific and stuff like that. But it is time for India to again embark on that neighborhood policy. And this time, not as a big brother, but this time as working along with like-minded countries. So maybe the policy it is adopting for its Indo-Pacific strategy. Maybe that policy can be adopted in South Asian diplomacy as well.
Yeah, I'm getting a message from the organizers that we need to wrap this up. Do we have just 2 minutes? Jabin, do you want to just...
I'll take just a minute, So I'm going to go with 3 words here. One is capacity, the other is agency, and the third is ideas. So capacity, ultimately, no matter what categories you have, whatever ideas you might have, you just cannot impose anything or persuade somebody else if you do not have the capacity. South Asia was imposed precisely because the US has capacity. China is unraveling South Asia as we understand it today precisely because it has capacity. Mm-hmm. But also let's remember, there's the question of agency. Smaller countries today have agency. They can play the big guys off against each other. Nepal is doing that. SAARC, remember, was a Bangladeshi idea, which is probably why other countries in the region accepted it. If it had been an Indian idea, they would not have. But then the third thing is a question of, but also related to agency is that, as Premisha pointed out, India needs to come back now and learn a more humble version of, learn greater humility in trying to reach out to other countries. Third, ideas. I mean, you need to be able to sell your ideas. Akhand Bharat will not sell, all right? Chinese are coming out Belt and Road Initiative, which many people are willing to take on. So what is the idea that India can sell and persuade people to climb on board? I think that's still democracy. And if we sort of, walk away from democracy at home, there's no way we are going to succeed in anything from the other, in other parts of the world, or in the rest of South Asia. So yeah, I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Jabin. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all my panelists. I think we can carry on this conversation forever, it seems. And also thank NIICE for giving us the platform to discuss these issues. And the next panel is about to begin, so I'll just end it here. But thanks a lot. This is an ongoing conversation.